For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today is October the 26th, 2012. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you today. This is Live News for Christians on TKSCM. TKSCM is the Knowledge Seeker Christian Ministry. I am servant of God, Pastor Anne, and I seek always to be a faithful servant of our Lord Jesus Christ with all humility by his grace and his mercy. Thanking you for tuning in to Live News for Christians today with Minister Deshpal Paul Sandhu of signsoftheend.com. Let us now ask the Lord to bless this broadcast, even as we prepare to do his work. Heavenly Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, we give thanks, O Lord, that we're here to do thy work. And we ask thee, O Lord, to be with us, to bless us, to sanctify us with thy truth. Sanctify this hour that we're here to do thy work. Bless all the listeners and to give us the ears to hear and the hearts to understand. Help us to increase in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding concerning all of the things which we will be examining today to help us to understand these end times and the signs of the end which is surely to come. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we do make this prayer unto thee, O Heavenly Father, by the power of the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, and we do say Amen and Amen. Praising our Lord God. And so, brothers and sisters in Christ, all fellow Christians and whoever is listening, even if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we give thanks for your presence. We give thanks for your interest. As we now bring on Minister Deshpal Paul Sandhu of signsoftheend.com, who is my co-host here on Live News for Christians. Minister Deshpal Paul Sandhu, I know you're with us.
Yes, I am. Thank you, Pastor Ann. And I say amen to your prayers, and yes, I'm ready to go. So whenever we can begin with this week's program with the news stories that you have posted on your website on News for Christians. So I am ready and set to go.
Okay, so here we are on the News for Christians website, and just to let everybody get a view of that, this is the website which carries all of the different news items. And the first item that we're seeing here is over 100 dead as communal violence rocks Myanmar. Do you want to comment on that?
Well, the purpose for doing these broadcasts, News for Christians, is to compare current events to biblical prophecy to see if we are witnessing the fulfillment of prophecy, or perhaps these are indicative of the quick or the soon or fulfillment of prophecy in the very near future. These stories like this, which are becoming very common these days, about the protests, revolutions, social unrest, and a general state of agitation in nations across the world, it reminds me, of course, of Matthew 24:7, that nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, as well as of Revelation chapter 6, verse 4, about the red horse and the rider that goes out with a big sword. And his job is to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. So these are signs of that which is to come. And I think in the future, perhaps in the near future, we will see much more of this sort of violence in many more countries, some of them which may be seen as relatively stable at the moment, but destabilization can happen almost overnight, as we have especially seen over the last couple of years.
Okay, I know that this next item, certainly you would comment on it. I think you blogged on this, did you not?
Yes, I did, I did.
Do you want to tell us what this is saying?
Well, this is a story about Libya. Libya has been a very tragic story because...
First of all, the headline. It says 600 killed in Bani Walid fighting in one day.
Right, so Bani Walid is in Libya. And it is reportedly or allegedly a stronghold of Gaddafi supporters. And for those who are not familiar with this, with what happened in Libya, Libya was a country that was ruled by this gentleman named Colonel Gaddafi, who ruled that country for 42 years. And when he started his rule 42 years ago, Libya was essentially a desert outpost with a few villages and hardly any sort of infrastructure and anything that would be considered to be a civilized place. It was a very nomadic country with many tribes spread out over a large landmass. So Colonel Gaddafi, in his rule over 42 years, he stabilized and united that country, and he made it into what was probably the richest country in all of Africa. It was comparable. It was one of the best second world countries, at least approaching a first world status. So, for whatever purposes and reasons, NATO and the United States in last year decided that Colonel Gaddafi was a terrorist. I mean, they didn't come to this realization for 42 years, but all of a sudden they did, and that he must be deposed. So they sent in their planes and warplanes and bombers. And they ran 10,000 bombing sorties over that country and really destroyed what was considered to be the jewel of North Africa. And in the process, they killed thousands of people, including Colonel Gaddafi. He was brutally murdered in cold blood. And now this Libya is essentially an anarchist country where there are a whole bunch of militias running around trying to stake out their territory. It is nothing like what it used to be under Gaddafi, and I'm sure that the majority of Libyans they long for the days of stability and prosperity that they experienced under Gaddafi. And I'm not trying to eulogize or praise Gaddafi. I'm sure in my understanding, everybody that has some sort of political power in this world is corrupt at a certain level. But at the same time, we cannot deny all the good that he did, not just for his own country, but also for the continent of Africa. And therefore, now these militias that are financed and armed by the West, they are completely destroying what is left of that country. And this place in Beni called Bani Walid is a city there that has been under siege. And there are reports of horrific genocide that is going on there. Yet we hear nothing about this on BBC, on CNN, and other Western media outlets that are entirely focused on Syria at the moment.
Okay, and so the importance for us as Christians concerning all that you have just said.
Well, this again ties into that prophecy of nation rising against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And when I look at these things, if you try to understand them from a logical perspective, there really was absolutely nothing logical about this invasion of Libya. So all what has happened in North Africa with Egypt and Tunisia and Morocco, with all their problems that they have had in those nations, what is currently happening in Syria and spreading soon to Lebanon and eventually all over the Middle East, none of these stories have any sort of reasonable explanation that there is a reasonable justification for them. So what I see in all of these things, as they are growing right before our eyes, that peace is being taken from the earth. And therefore, I have to conclude that these things are pointing to a fulfillment of prophecy, that there is no plausible explanation why these invasions were necessary or to explain what is going on right now there. It is just that there is the lack of peace is spreading everywhere in the world, and that prophecy that they should kill one another is being fulfilled in these events.
Yes, and can you just expand on that a little bit concerning the Middle East in general? Because, okay, we have spoken, and as you have said, the people in the know, like yourself, consider that it is a high possibility or probability that World War III or any other great conflict will take over the whole world will begin right there in the Middle East. And so we're going back to last year, the Arab Spring, and maybe the year before a little bit, but certainly last year and into this year. Remind us, as we see these headlines, as Christians, what should we, be gleaning from this, from our point of view, all of this, not just Libya?
Well, for those who are following along our studies on Matthew 24 and Revelation and the book of Revelation, or even students of prophecy in general, they are well aware that one of the first and major signs that we will have entered this time, which the Lord termed the beginning of sorrows or the birth pangs that is going to birth in the return of the Lord Jesus himself into a new age and a new world, that time is going to be one in which one of the major signs that will be unmistakable will be global war. And global war does not necessarily mean like one single war. It could mean a series of wars. So in that region in the Middle East, that would be considered to be hotspot number one right now, especially with all the rhetoric that has been going on recently between Iran and Israel. And Israel, of course, is a proxy for the United States and the West in general. So any war that will involve Israel would automatically involve NATO and the USA. And because on the other side, we have Russia and China and even countries like India that have more of an allegiance to Iran and to the Muslim world than they do to the West. So these lines, these battle lines are being drawn. And at some point in time, this whole thing is going to erupt into the biggest war that we have ever seen. But that war in itself could be a combination of a whole series of wars that will be fought between different nations and different regions. And it could very well begin with this destabilization of the Middle East, because as long as the nations in there were relatively stable, as they were under Mubarak, who was there for 30 years in Syria, the Assads have ruled it for decades, and so on and so forth. Thus, there has been a relative stability in the region. Therefore, in order for the whole region to explode, so to speak, all this destability had to be fomented and induced, and that is what we are seeing, because this is definitely something that is being induced from outer external forces that are at work here. These are not grassroots revolutions that are happening in these nations.
Okay, and we know that there's a lot of Christian persecution in these areas, and we can probably look at that in a minute. But let us remember concerning what you said last week or last broadcast here concerning Turkey. And we see now, today we get Turkey, an aggressive emerging Islamist autocracy that may soon become the greatest threat to Israel.
Yes, you know, it is this whole thing with Israel being the nation that has been the creation of Israel itself is in modern times is a very interesting story. But it has always been purposed that eventually that would be the fuse that would light this whole area and eventually the world into World War III. Those plans to bring this about, they go back a long time. And this is what we are seeing a culmination of. Now, of course, there are human plans and there are satanic plans, but ultimately, of course, we know that it is the plans of our Lord God, the omnipotent creator of all things, that are going to stand. And those plans we can read about in prophecy. And therefore, it is not a surprise that the Muslim world is being alienated and it is being set up as a foe of the West from people who call themselves Christians but are anything but Christian. So these battle lines are going to be, this is going to be a war of civilizations. It is also going to be a culmination of the crusades that began 1,000 years ago. And it is also has a spiritual component to it in the sense that this is a war between Islam and Catholicism, basically. Islam is the worship of the moon, okay? If you look at these flags and symbols, it is Luna. And therefore, there is a spiritual component that they are the worshippers of the moon goddess. And on the other side is the Catholic religion, which is a sun worship religion, okay? They worship the sun. They are, their god is the sun god, not the son of God, but the sun as the object or the body we see, celestial body we see in the sky that gives us heat and light. So they are sun worshipers. If you go into any Catholic church, they have that, I forget what they call it, but it's like the sun with the rays coming out, you know, and anytime they have a procession or the Pope comes out, it's they have those things. So this is an ancient animosity that goes back a long time, thousands of years. So this is what it's going to be culminated in. And this is the spiritual component of it, which is also at play here.
Okay, so concerning the Christian persecution in that region, there is quite a lot of news concerning how, like for instance, here we have this one here, President Morsi there in Egypt denies Christian persecution in Egypt. And we know that he's, was he not high in the Muslim Brotherhood and all of that? Do you have anything that you want to say about what is happening there in Egypt and the fact that President Morsi needs to deny that Christians are being persecuted in Egypt? And how does it affect us here in the West, that we sort of perhaps feel a bit far removed from it, although we have our own different forms of persecution, which there's also another a lot of news on that. But since we're still on the subject of war and the Middle East and the Islamic, as it were, domination, would you like to comment on this, President Morsi denying that Christians are being persecuted? And what does that mean?
Well, the persecution of Christians should not come as a surprise to anybody, because if we look at the very beginning of Christianity, it begins with our Lord, after whom we are named the Christians. You know, he himself was persecuted and eventually tortured and killed, as were his apostles and the early leaders of the church. And that has continued throughout the ages. In the Middle Ages, or in the Dark Ages, you know, it was a common practice for the Catholic Church to burn real Christians at the stake. And so it is nothing new. And therefore, this thing that, you know, and the Lord has warned us very succinctly in Matthew 24:9, that we shall be hated of all nations, that they will persecute us and they will kill us. So these things are happening in countries right now where Christians are perceived to be a minority. It is also true that Christians, real Christians, true believers in Christ Jesus, they are also a minority everywhere in every country in the world, you know, like whether in the UK or USA, the real Christians are a minority here too. And as the world itself begins to disintegrate, come apart at the seams economically, politically, militarily, and in every other respect, and we are also being buffeted by major storms and other problems, then this persecution is going to only increase. It is not going to decrease. So therefore, you know, like, it is not surprising that this is happening. And of course, the people that are doing it, they will always be denying it. They are not going to come out and say we are specifically involved in this sort of activity.
Okay, I'm just going to run through some of these headlines here. We've done the President Morsi one, and we've got this one, Worldwide Video Leads to Christian Persecution. That was that big thing over there, you know, that Innocence of the Muslims video. And apparently that has led to more persecution of Christians. We have this one, Christian persecution intensifies around the globe. Rally in Rome spotlights Christian persecution. China intensifies Christian persecution. Police detain church leader. Christian persecution in India. Summary of recent attacks. Why is Christian persecution in Saudi Arabia ignored? And controversy over the Voice of Martyrs materials, which aim to teach children about Christian persecution, and so on. I think that's enough. We've under Christian persecution, we've got hundreds or perhaps thousands of items. But
one thing I want to comment on this is a lot of these organizations, okay, they are affiliated with denominational Christianity and they are affiliated with the Roman Catholic Church. They are not truly concerned about any sort of Christian persecution because they themselves, their organizations are anything but Christian. So this here, I would be wary of a lot of these reports that when they say it's Christian persecution, what exactly is it that they are speaking about and what is the real agenda behind it that they are bringing out all these reports at this present time? I can't say I know what the agenda is, but I'm sure there is some. Okay, that somebody is going to benefit it. Either they're going to use this, create an emotional response from rich American people and churches or whatever and gain money. That is always an agenda that people, they always say, oh, there's persecution in Pakistan, we got to help them, so please give us money. But that money never ends up helping real Christians because these people who are in these organizations, they are actually the enemies of Christianity. So persecution is very alive and well in the UK and USA. It is not physical persecution at the moment, but the persecution of the Christian ideology is much stronger in America than it would be, for example, in Saudi Arabia, where they don't even know what the ideology is.
Okay, so when our Lord Jesus Christ told us that we would be persecuted, okay, and again,
they're already being persecuted here because anything that's deemed to be Christian, you know, like even now Christmas is coming, which of course we know is not really a biblical event. It is a pagan holiday. But even then in America or in the UK or whatever, you know, churches used to have this little nativity scene. People are not even allowed to do that. You're not even allowed to say Merry Christmas anymore. So are these Christian countries that we are living in? No, all traces of Christianity, anything that even superficially made these nations Christians is being deliberately by legislation being removed from these nations, and therefore the stage is being set for a widespread persecution to the extent of being, killing people is being set in these countries. So eventually when real Christian persecution arises, you know, it is logical that most of the Christians will be found in countries that have some sort of Christian background. In a Hindu country like India, there are not many Christians to begin with. But in a country like America, perhaps, there would be a lot more. So I would be more wary of persecution that's going to arise here than about something that might be happening in India or Pakistan, where there are only maybe a handful of Christians to start off with.
Okay, well, we do know that in these countries, for instance, in the Islamic countries and countries of other religions where Christians live, Christians are more, obviously persecuted than Christians in the West. Is that not so? I mean, imprisoned.
I would imagine so, but Pastor Ann, you know, like to look at the thing in perspective, in a country like India, for example, there's always one group persecuting another group. So, you know, like, I mean, yes, we look at it, this Christian persecution that these mainstream organizations are trying to, you know, draw our attention to, I think that is more of an agenda to raise money than anything else. But in a country like India, you know, it's like the Hindus will be persecuting the Muslims will be persecuting the Sikhs will be persecuting the Buddhists. It goes all around, you know, there are many types of things happening against many groups. It is not just the one group that alone is being persecuted. But the type of persecution that we are talking about, the biblical kind, which is yet to come in my estimation, even in some of these countries like Egypt, it is not the type that is yet, that is going to happen. It is going to be of a much more extreme, extremely deadly persecution is going to arise. But I would not worry about it in places like Egypt or Pakistan or Jordan or Saudi Arabia. I would be more concerned about it in the UK and in the USA.
That is very true, that there is a lot of subtle persecution here. And perhaps in another broadcast, we can look at that. I just would not like the audience to feel that you're in any way delimiting the importance of the Christians over there, especially those who have converted from another religion into being a Christian. Whether you consider them to be genuine or not, that perhaps is another issue. But I would not like the audience to feel that you are insensitive to the fact that Christians, professed followers of Christ, are really suffering and being imprisoned and beaten and all the atrocities that take. I mean, over there in Nigeria, we have seen attack upon attack Boko Haram, or Haram, I think. And these people are dying, children are dying when churches are bombed and so on. And so I'm just sort of suggesting that the way you're coming across is as if these persecutions are not important. Yes, here it is, Boko Haram. These are not important. And so people like this over there listening, or people in, like we had an item, I believe, today concerning Nigerians in America that are calling for help to help the situation. Just a minute. Let me just get that, because what I'm trying to say is I do understand what you're saying concerning there are powers that be that capitalize off Christianity. That has always been. From the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, we find that they wanted to remember, what was his name? Simon the sorcerer. He wanted to capitalize so early off of it, and that's never stopped. But so that the audience does not go away thinking that, Deshpal Sandhu and, you know, Pastor Ann there on News for Christians, our persecution is nothing, you know, blah, blah, blah.
I'm not talking about that. Yes, I know there are people who suffer and genuinely suffer. That's no doubt about that. But I am very wary of organization like this here. Stop, you know, who are these people? I don't know who they are. Who's funding them? Who's financing them? What is their real agenda?
Sorry,
I know too much about the charitable.
Sorry, who was that you mentioned?
This year, you know, you said the Boko Haram or whatever it is.
No, they are the Muslims, the Nigerian.
But I mean, the people that are urging action against them, who are they? You know, where is their funding coming from? What organization? There are a lot of charitable organizations that raise a lot of money, but they are anything but charitable. As, for example, in Haiti, you know, after that earthquake, they raised billions and billions of dollars. And if anybody went to Haiti today, it's probably in worse shape than it was on the day that the earthquake hit. So, you know, these kind of organizations, I really, because I understand, like, you know, how that the ultimate motivation of a lot of this reporting that goes on in the so-called Christian press, it is always serving an agenda that is anything but charitable. Therefore, I'm very skeptical of a lot of these reports that come out. That may be true that there is persecution going on out there, and I'm sure there is, but perhaps none of this, not as much as they are telling us at the moment, or perhaps not in the way that it is being reported, and perhaps even the people that in many cases are being killed and murdered, they may not even be Christians. They may be just another ethnic group that for some reason has come in the crosshairs of the ruling government or something like that. So these stories, all I'm saying is please take them with a grain of salt, because in many cases they'll be proven to be untrue in the future. So we need to be aware of what is happening right here in our backyard. And I think I wish that the churches here would take a stand for God and Jesus Christ, and that, you know, they wouldn't allow all these ungodly legislations that are passed every day and to make our country more and more pagan. That is a much more crucial and a much greater danger to us all, not just to people who are living here, but to the whole world, is the anti-Christianization of the two greatest defenders of Christianity, if there ever were any, and that, of course, would be the UK and the USA.
I certainly cannot disagree with you in terms of the persecution here in the West. It is something I believe that we're going to talk about quite a lot in future broadcasts. But again, I just wanted to emphasize that I do not believe, knowing you, Minister Deshpal Paul Sundu, that you're in any way, as it were, marginalizing the suffering Christians in other parts of the world.
No, I have seen suffering Christians myself. Okay, in India, I've seen it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but those people are not, one of those people would ever be helped by any Western organization. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's where I have a problem with these organizations that set themselves up. When I go to this Bible Gateway website, for example, they always have pictures of, martyrs and but the ultimate motivation is, oh, please donate money.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the problem is. If you want to, help somebody, then make sure that you know who they are and, what their situation is in reality. Don't talk to somebody that's on the ground there, because the story may be quite different from the perspective of the people that are living there than what is being reported. Because nothing that is reported in the mainstream media, whether it's secular news or so-called religious news, there's always an angle behind it, and that angle is never godly. That's all I'm trying to say. I know there are real people that are being persecuted, that are even being killed. I have met some of them. I know some of them. So I don't doubt that, but I do doubt a lot of these stories that come out in the so-called Christian press.
So what you're saying is that some of these stories concerning persecution that even we carry here on News for Christians, they may not be totally true. Is that what
that's you're right? That's correct. That's what I am saying. Yes.
Okay. So here's my question to you: should we carry them?
I personally. That entirely is your decision. I don't see anything.
No, I'm asking your opinion. I mean, okay, here's a report. For instance, a report comes out concerning persecution wherever, and it's in one of these.
I would examine the source where it comes from. I would really look closely at that organization. What organization is putting this report out? That would where I would begin.
Okay,
and so if I'm not comfortable with that organization, I wouldn't report it.
Sorry?
I said, if I'm not comfortable with the organization mm-hmm. that is reporting that story, then I wouldn't report it.
Okay, so, well, I'd just like to say that our view here on News for Christians is we try to keep away from politics unless we see that it directly relates to very closely, put it this way, directly or indirectly, relates to something that will guide us or give us further information or understanding concerning, even as you would say, Matthew 24, the times of the end. And so we do not, we're not political or anything like that, but we do try to carry all types of different news. When I look at the news, I say, okay, is this going to help the reader or the person who's listening if they're listening to these, is it going to help them to understand that really these are signs of the end? Okay, and so that's what we carry. So for instance, Haiti, this news here, Haiti, flooded in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy. And we see that it's been, whoever it's been carried, what you're saying, Minister Deshpal Paul Sandu, is that if I'm to carry something like this, I must go and say, well, who put this out? Should we believe them? Blah, 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 blah.
No, I'm not saying that. Like when we have news reports that are coming out on Reuters or something, you know, yes, I understand that they are slanted in most cases, okay? But, I mean, they are, those are the sources that we have. What I was talking about specifically was information that comes out of religious organizations. Because religious organizations, they should be held to a higher standard. I expect CNN to be lying to me, okay, or BBC to be lying, or Reuters to be lying, or to be slanting, or to be having an agenda. But it's too often that, you know, organizations that call themselves Christians, such as World Vision, for example, that people, you know, don't put them under, they don't examine their information with a critical eye. That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying that we should, you know, if we stopped using all these sources, we would have no news to report on.
Okay, I would just like to say that for me, my role is not to go and to examine and to scrutinize those sources. When I put the news out there, if I see that the headline suggests that it's something which a Christian ought to take note of, I also give the source, and it's up to each and every Christian individual or anybody who's reading to go and follow up. And we do get comments on the news item. People are free to comment here, even on the blog, and to say, well, okay, this doesn't sound true, or this is whatever, and they do comment. And so I do understand what you're saying, and I hope that we have made it very clear to the audience your position and even the position of News for Christians. I don't go through a filtering whether this particular organization has a great agenda concerning what they're doing just to make money. For instance, some of the news items that we carry, I may not like what it says. I may be totally against it, but I need to put the news out there so that people can at least see what is news, what people are writing about, what people are saying, what is happening, what are people's views, and then they can at least make informed decisions. And if I were to really start filtering, I think it'd be very scanty, maybe about 5 or 10 items at the most, because most of them I either find them a bit iffy or I don't like what they say or something. But at least the individual needs to see the news and make their own decisions. Minister Deshpal Paul Sandu.
Yes, you're right. You know, it's as I said, like it's entirely, you know, since you are the webmaster for this website, it's entirely up to you what you wish to post on there. I'm not saying that, you know, there's anything wrong with being posted there. All I'm saying is that all news items should be critically evaluated to get the underlying story that is in the headline.
Well, of course, we do remember that even there in Matthew 24, we are very much warned of deception, okay? And of course, the news media is one of the, I suppose, the biggest places where you can, as it were, fool the people through the newspapers and the television and the radio, all of the different sources. We know that everybody knows that. And so one is aware.
What I was trying to emphasize was to our listeners is that, you know, a lot of people may not be that critical of organizations that call themselves Christians, okay? Like if it's a Christian news magazine that is reporting a certain story, you know, that does not necessarily make it true. Okay? Mm-hmm. In a lot of those cases, they are fiction. Mm-hmm. And that's why we should examine, you know, whatever report is coming out, mm-hmm. whether it's coming from a so-called Christian agency or from the BBC or any other place, We should all, we should be critical of them all, and we should try to get to the underlying story. For example, yes, when I report on Libya or in Syria, like, I'm not giving the same angle as Reuters would when they are reporting it. I try to get to the, you know, the, to what the real, what is the, what I perceive to be the real events that are going on and who are the players in it. And that's the sort of information that I try and present on to, you know, my viewers and listeners.
Well, yes, I mean, even I'm not a Catholic and I don't support any, I don't support that, that denomination or that religion, but from time to time, or very often, I do carry a lot of news concerning what the Catholics are doing, what the Pope is saying, what is happening there in the Vatican, because I believe that it is important for us to have an understanding of what is going on. This item here, I believe, is perhaps one that you would, we could use an as an example concerning what you're trying to say, Minister Deshpalpul Sandhu. It says prayers requested for huge evangelistic festival in Egyptian desert. And perhaps, I don't know, I don't want to be preemptive, but perhaps you would say, you would be a bit critical or skeptical concerning what's the agenda behind this. Is that a good example?
Yes, I'm sure it's, it is. I mean, they want to have all these people gathered together in Egypt and saying these prayers, which obviously, from my perspective, I would be 100% sure that these are prayers that are going up to some kind of pagan Egyptian gods, because, you know, in the occult, the place in Egypt, they say that it has a lot of energy and to bring about their New Age movements. So it's guised as Christianity, but ultimately what they'll be praying to is these ancient Egyptian gods. And, you know, asking for their blessings upon whatever agenda that they have. It is not, you know, Christians, as Christians, we don't need to go to the Egyptian desert. We can just go into our closet and pray.
Can you just read this item here and tell me if how you view this one?
Okay, sorry, my website's for some reason, it's kind of gone a little, it's frozen. So, but I'm on your News for Christians, not on the live stream, but on the other website. Which news item?
Okay. Since you can't see, it might be a bit difficult for you.
No, I can see it on your website, not on the live stream.
Azerbaijan, can't pronounce it, is confiscating religious literature censorship.
Azerbaijan is confiscating religious literature.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That the customs and secret police officers spent more than 6 hours searching a family minibox returning. And we've had a lot of news out of these areas like this, by the way. Returning from Russia, seizing religious literature they found hidden and confiscating the van and the driver's passport. And members of the family reported this to the Forum 18 news service. And they've been sent, the things that they seized have been sent up to, what's it called, the state, the State Committee for Work with Religious Organizations in Baku for religious expert analysis.
Yes, see, first of all, I would be skeptical of a story such as this is first of all, if this was a genuine case where there was these authorities had deliberately, you know, confiscated all of this, it is highly unlikely that it would make it into the world press, okay? Because
this is in Forum 18. That is a different kind of press which deals with these sort of things, and apparently the family themselves reported it to them.
All right, so, you know, I mean,
it's not the mainstream media.
Fair enough. Okay, fine. You know, so they got why is that? Was it Bibles that they were confiscating? What kind of religious literature are they talking about here?
I don't quite know the details, but
we don't know what it's about. That is why a lot of these stories, they are very scanty on detail. You know, like it could be religious literature. It could mean the Tibetan Book of the Dead as well. It could mean you know, the Quran.
They do give a lot of details. When you follow this, it's quite a lot. But here on News for Christians, I only give a paragraph, just enough. And
you know, what I'm saying is, I do not know what this story is about rich religious literature it's about. Is it about like confiscating Bibles? Yes, of course, a lot of countries have those sort of laws where they restrict importation of Bibles and Christian literature. That is not surprising. It has always been, those sort of laws have been around the world for a long time. So it shouldn't surprise us. What is going to happen eventually? What in it is going to be a cause of concern when, in the name of hate speech or something like that, that it's in the West that we will be with that our Bibles will be subject to confiscation or religious gatherings will be outlawed. Those sort of things will come. And
It is here, actually.
yes, it is already here in a subtle way, but I think they will become more and more overt as time goes by. And that is something which I think is of is greater concern, whether they are confiscating Bibles in Azerbaijan. I don't think is a big issue as such, because I mean that is a very small country to begin with, and it is a Muslim country, so I doubt that there are that many Christians there to start off with that can have a global impact, where these events and these sort of policies are going to impact globally. It is in Western countries when these policies are enacted, in legislated and enacted in our countries. That is when we will see real persecution, and it will be deadly.
Well, okay, so with this organization here called the Christian Association of Nigerian Americans, calling for help to end the violence against believers, is that okay with you?
Not, I'm not sure who these people are. I mean, that's they call themselves that, and if it is it is something that they are genuinely concerned about their brethren there, then yes, it's absolutely okay, and we should do, if we can help them, if in no other way than through our prayers, then we should. Okay, I don't say that that we shouldn't, and but I mean, for them to expect any help from the U.S. government, that is not going to be forthcoming.
Okay, just perhaps the last one on this subject here. LSU, which is the Lu Louisiana State University, making their apology there for editing out the cross in the picture of students. This story was carried, apparently the students had a cross, and when they digitally edited out the cross, and so when they saw the end product of the pictures, it wasn't there, and so of course they made a fuss about it, and an apology has come. This is a sort of persecution, assuming it's okay, as you would want to say, assuming they are genuine Christians or whatever, that is here in the West, that you're not even free to have to wear a cross. I mean, we have stories concerning people not in the UK, people not being free to wear a cross to work. They're not, their cross can't be visible. You can't hand out any material. You can't do any, how is it? You can't do any evangelizing, or you can't talk about your faith in the workplace. That is very much here, and we do have a lot of stories on that. So concerning even this story here, is there anything you wanted to say about this? I mean, the fact that they would go so far, the Louisiana State University, censoring the photographs because they had the cross off, which represents their Christianity on it.
Well, this is what you call a slippery slope down which we have been going a long time. So it's not surprising that they would resort to such deviousness, and I think eventually these sort of activities will only increase on an official level, as they have been very much so over the past 30, 40 years.
Okay, fine. So we have sort of looked at some of the issues as we have carried them
I
here.
have to go in a few minutes, but before we go, I want to comment on one of the stories on your website here, News for Christians. It's called the And in the UK, I'm sure it's a big scandal over this Saville, Jimmy Saville, the pedophile story. And on my blog, in Apocalypse 2010, over the past few weeks, there have been many stories, starting with Jerry Sandusky and the pedophile ring at Pennsylvania and in the USA. And these are just keep coming one after the other. And now there's, of course, the story about in the BBC about some British prime minister and members of parliament that were involved in some kind of organized pedophile rings. And this is what I want to, people to realize that this sort of activity, this is not the exception, that the people at the highest levels of power structure in our world, they are absolutely have been involved in such sort of activities that involve child sex and, abuse. It goes back thousands of years. And the people at the top of our societies, they are very sick individuals. Okay, they literally are devils walking around in human bodies. Okay, those are the kind of people that we should not give our assent to. And give our, give any sort of admiration to, as tends to be the case, especially in the UK, where it comes to royalty, for example, they're literally worshipped as gods, but they're anything but gods. And so these kind of...
Well, I suppose we should just let the audience know, many people may not know who this Jimmy Savile is, but he was like, I don't know, an icon there over... over here, and he was knighted by the Queen and so on, but he had an undercover lifestyle which was covered up by the BBC, and there again, the BBC is supposed to be such a respectable source, isn't it? And there it is. So here, this item here, it says arrest due over Saville's scandal. And can you see it? British police investigating alleged abuse of the late Jimmy Savile. He died, what, last year?
Exactly. And that's the whole point here, though. Like, now they're going to investigate once the man is dead. Mm-hmm. Same thing with this prime minister. He's sometime in the past. Instead of concentrating on what's happening now, in the Vatican, there's, or in the Catholic Church, abuse after abuse after abuse case comes to light, mm-hmm. some of them going back 30, 40 years. How come it is that our police forces are never able to catch these perpetrators?
And the Boy Scouts as well now.
Exactly, the Boy Scouts, the Child and Welfare Services. See, when we look at persecution, Pastor Ann, this is something which is, Jesus said it would be better that a millstone were hung about a person's neck and he was drowned in the depths of the sea, then he should offend one of these little ones. This too is a form of not just persecution, it's more than that, it's torture and murder that is happening to our children right where you live and where I live and all around the world. Okay, this is also something people should make themselves aware of, because it is your leaders that are, they are evil, evil, evil people, that they are doing these things, and they have been throughout history. And it is as we make ourselves aware of it that these things will come to light more and more. And will it really solve anything? I don't think so. But at least these things will no longer be hidden. And I'm thankful that these sort of reports now are coming out quite frequently, but sadly, the people that are supposed to be doing the investigations at the highest level, they themselves are compromised, so nothing will be done about it, but that at least gives us a true state of our world and of the leaders that run it.
Well, the Boy Scout perversion files being released here, that speaks volumes, because the files have been there. And here we see, I've got the news item here, thousands of pages of once private records detailing sex abuse allegations with the Boy Scouts of America from the mid-1960s to the mid-1980s were made public by Oregon court Thursday.
So what's happened since mid-1980s to now, you know, like, are we to believe when sodomy and other perversions have increased exponentially over these past 30 years, are we to believe that none of this stuff is going on anymore?
Well, or, of course, those can't be released till another 20 years.
So that just shows you the sick and depraved nature of our world.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the sure signs is that as sexual perversions increase in a society, going back to, you know, Babylon and Persia and ancient Egypt and ancient Greece and Rome, the end is close. These are also signs that tell us that the system and the society as we know it is on the verge of breakdown, because these things are something, especially offenses against children as they increase, they are sure to bring the wrath of God upon the perpetrators. And as more and more people get involved in these things, that time draws closer and closer.
Well, of course, we do have the prophecy scripture for that, but we're not going to go into details, you know, men lovers of themselves and all of that, and the love of many will grow cold and all of that wax cold. And so, again, you are very correct. These are signs of the end. And I hope perhaps in a future broadcast we can sort of touch on those issues a bit more so that people can understand really how it is showing the perverseness of the society, like in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah and in the days of Noah also, in which the wickedness of man was such that the Lord had to do what he did. So yes, indeed, wars and rumors of wars and earthquakes and all of these, yes, those are obvious. But as Minister Deshpal Paul Sandhu is trying to point out, look at society in general, look at the agendas that are forefront in societies. Look at the breakdown. Look at the things now which have become normal, which were once abominations. And if you try to, as it were, speak out against it,
these abominations, by the way, are very prevalent in our school systems.
Mm-hmm.
Children in their preteens are being taught things and shown pictures and videos of such abominations that I can't even mention them on these programs.
Please don't. Yes, I know what you're saying. Yes.
So these are signs, you know. We just don't have to look at, you know, somebody, you know, that calls themselves a Christian being persecuted for their faith. These are innocent children who don't yet know, you know, the good from evil. And as it tells us, you know, their right hand from their left hand. They're not old, but these are victims that are victims of the system that grows more and more evil by the day.
To say on this subject, because even the very people that run the schools, they are that themselves. So, of course, they perpetuate it,
first of all,
quietly, but increasingly more openly.
So what I'm saying is, people, don't just look at, you know, has there been a big earthquake? Has there been a major, you know, famine somewhere? Yes, those are all signs, but so are these.
Look at the world
around you and how it's degenerating, and it is becoming corrupt and abominable, as Sodom was before the Lord acted. So why would we escape judgment? Why would the world in the present day escape judgment if Sodom didn't?
In the time of Noah.
That's
Noah,
correct.
Yes.
The time when Noah didn't, and so I think we are definitely more evil than they probably were.
Very much, I would agree.
Anyways, Pastor, and I have to go now.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for having me on your program, and we had this opportunity to share again. And God willing, we'll be back next week with another update.
Okay, thank you very much. May the Lord continue to bless your ministry, and looking forward to our next News for Christians, Live News for Christians, and also, of course, the signs of the end of last days. The Lord be with you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And so I'm going to close off now, giving thanks to Minister Deshpal Paul Sandhu, and asking that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen.